If you're new to Airtable, or databases in general, you might be a little bit confused about how linking works when you have two records that connect and you want to inherit information through that connection. In this video, I'm going to be breaking down three very important fields that Airtable shares with us, and they focus on this very thing. I'm talking about counting, lookup, or rollup fields. This is all about how linked records work together and how we're able to find or extrapolate information from that linked relationship, and we are breaking it down in this video step by step. So if you're ready to learn how the linked records in Airtable really work so that you can inherit information through that linked relationship, you've come to the right place. Stick around and let's get into it. Welcome back to the channel. If you're new here, my name is Gareth and this is Gap Consulting. It's my mission here to help you unlock the full potential of Airtable and related no-code tools. And in this video, as I said, we're going to be breaking down three very important fields that Airtable shares with us. And it all has to do with how things are linked and how we can inherit information through that linked relationship. And if that sounds a little complicated, don't worry. We are going to be breaking it down step by step so that you can follow along here. Now, before we do get into the heart of things, I first want to invite you to join me for some free training. I've put together what I call the Airtable Crash Course, and you can sign up for free. And we are going to deliver to your email a series of bite-sized videos so that you can learn all the core functions of Airtable and really get up to speed with what this software does. So if that's of interest, grab that free training at gapconsulting.io/airtable-crash-course. And I will include a link for that training wherever you found this video. Now, without further ado, let's hop on into my screen. I want to encourage you to follow along in your own Airtable account. I have two simple tables, and note that I am in the data layer. So I'm in the back end here. I'm not in interfaces. I'm not building automations. What we're talking about here is how we structure our database. And I'm going to take a pretty simple example of projects and tasks. So I've got two simple projects here. Nothing crazy, just the linked relationship to tasks. You can see that project one links to six different tasks and project two links to just one task or task seven. Now let's flip on over to our tasks table and take a look at what we have. Now to make this a little bit easier to understand what task is assigned to what project, I can group by the project field and I'm just doing this as a visual representation of which tasks are going to which project so we can see it at a glance. So again, these six tasks right here are attached to project one, and then this last task, task seven, is attached to project two. So that relationship is reciprocal. When we connect one thing to another, then that connection, that link, is bidirectional. So on this side, this is our link to the projects. Our next field is who it's assigned to. So I've assigned some different tasks to two different people, either Sarah or myself. We also have a status of the task, whether it's in progress, in review, or complete. Every task has a due date, and you'll see that for the sake of this example, these tasks are very overdue, right? We have tasks that were due back in May 5th, 2025. As of my recording, it's September, so these things are really overdue. Now, we also have a formula here that is calculating how many days something is overdue. But one thing I want to point out is we only want to calculate if something is overdue if the due date was before today. But there's actually another rule or stipulation that we might want to put into play. And that is to say that the status of it is not complete. Because if a task is complete, or if the due date is after today, then it's not overdue and we don't need to calculate this. So we're going to amend this little formula here and add some stuff to it. We're going to say, and the status of this is not equal to, and we can call out the complete status here. So let's go ahead and close that off. And I've just updated my formula. Now, by the way, if you're kind of new to formula writing, you can always create a formula with AI. You can always speak to the AI just as you would, you know, with plain language and get a formula created for you. But in our case, we're just going to go ahead and save the changes we made. And you'll see now that we are only bringing in the days overdue if the status is not complete. So if the task is still ongoing, that is, it's not yet complete, and it is past due or due in a time that was before today, then we want to calculate the days overdue. So this is not the count, this is not the rollup or the lookup, but we're going to use the data that we have in our tasks table in our counts, our lookups, and our rollups. So let's get to work now that we understand the structure that we have in our simple project management here. So I want to look up information about my tasks at the project level. Now, the first thing I want to call out is that we care what tasks we're connected to. For example, if we were wanting to count the number of tasks that we have, we don't care if we're not linked to a task. So we only really want to know about the tasks that are linked to each project. So for project one, that count is simple. We see it's connected to 6 tasks. For project two, it's connected to 1, etc. If we need to display this information, that is our first dependent field that we're going to use. It's the count field. So let's go ahead and look up count here. And we can just put in whatever name we would like. The first thing that we're asked to do is look at the source. And this has to be a linked relationship. In our case, the link to tasks. If you've linked projects to multiple different tables, you have to choose which link you want to look at. So this one's pretty straightforward, right? If we just create the field right now, boom, we're done. We get exactly what we would expect. 6 tasks, 1 task. But we can go a little deeper than this. Let's go back in our count and toggle on the including of linked records under certain conditions. Because now what we might care about is how many tasks do we have that are not yet complete? So we could say, for example, I want you to count not all of the tasks, but the tasks where status is not or is none of complete. So therefore, essentially saying, I want you to count the tasks where they're in progress or in review. So just like that, we can save this up. And now we see that we have 4 tasks that are not complete and 0 tasks. So these are ongoing tasks, and we could rename the field that, right? We could call this ongoing tasks. We can go over to our tasks and verify that that is correct. We have 1, 2, 3, 4 tasks associated with project one that are not complete. And that is why we're getting 4 right here. And if we look at project two, it only has this task assigned to it, and this task is complete, so it's not an ongoing task. And that's why we're getting a 0 when we go on our projects here. So that is how the count field works. And note that we can update multiple conditions here. We can set up a number of different conditions and condition groups if we want to do some more complicated logic. So we could drag some conditions inside of a group. We could say inside the group, 2 conditions must be simultaneously true, and then we can make this an OR condition. So this could be something like the project is a specific project, or it's assigned to a specific user, and we're putting all of this in our conditional logic when we do the counting. So I don't actually want that for our example, but it's important that you know that this is an option, and you can really get quite robust in the way that you build your filtering and your conditions inside of the count. Now let's take a look at our second field type, the lookup field. So lookups are kind of like the count field, but we're going to actually bring in information from the tasks table. So for example, we might want to know who are the users on a given project who have incomplete tasks. So if we had to click through into the tasks table, we could find this out. We could look and see, okay, Sarah has a task that is in progress, so we should know Sarah has an incomplete task, and we can look over here and see that Gareth still has a task that's incomplete as well. But what if we don't want to click into the tasks table? What if we need this information at the project level? Well, let's bring it in with a lookup field. So we're going to create that lookup field type, and again, name it whatever you like. This is not part of the setup of the field. Again, we're going to look here at the first selection is what the lookup source is. This field has everything to do with that linked relationship to tasks. And again, just as a reminder, if you have multiple tables linked here, you need to choose which one you want to look up. For us, it's just tasks that are linked to projects. Now, what field do we care about? We want to know, in our example, the names of people who have incomplete tasks. So we care about the assigned to field. Now, again, we could just put this in right now and create the field. And that's going to bring in every single person that has a task assigned to them. That's a lot, right? But I don't love this, right? What I really care about is to see the people who have tasks that are incomplete. So let's add some conditions. Just as we did earlier, we can toggle on conditions. So I can set up conditions that say something like, I want to see only where the status is any of in progress or in review. So if I were to save these conditions, I'm still going to see that Sarah has two tasks outstanding and Gareth has two tasks outstanding. So I'm getting a shorter list because the assigned tasks that are complete are not bringing that user back in. There you go. So we've now been able to look that up. We could do different types of lookups as well. So maybe we don't care so much who has overdue tasks. Maybe we want to see what the different due dates are for tasks that are not complete. So again, we're going to look at stuff that's in progress or in review. Let's bring that information back. So we get this nice list here. We see that there are four tasks that are not complete, and here are the due dates for those different tasks. But notice that the lookup field brings all of that in one field, and we can actually choose how that information gets displayed. We can sort it, for example. Maybe I want to put it in reverse chronological order. So I could say I want to rank it or sort it by due date backwards, from the latest due date to the earliest due date. And let's save it. So now I see it with August 22nd being the first in the list, and it counts backwards, basically in time, back to May 5th, 2025. So that's my sorting capability, and I can have multiple different ways of sorting this, and I can also choose how many data points I want to see. So for example, I could see, maybe I just want to see the earliest date of May 5th. Well, that's easy enough. I can say, well, I've sorted it in this order, and maybe I want to limit it to just the last number on that list. So just like that, I'm only looking at the last in the sequence. So you see, you've got a lot of options in how you're setting up your lookup field here. If you're not limiting the number, it's going to bring back everything that meets your conditional filters here. And of course, you can also sort the order that the data comes back to you. Now let's take a look at the rollup field, which is the most complicated of these three. The rollup field allows us to do some kind of aggregation function on the information that we are looking at. So for this, we're going to take a look at our tasks overdue, the days overdue field that we built here. Maybe we want to know the total number of days of all of the overdue tasks. So in this case, we want to sum 139 plus 104 plus 39, etc. And you can see that right here, we already have the sum on our tasks table. But if we need it on the projects table, that's where we're going to use this rollup field. So let's head back to projects and we'll build the rollup here. And using this, again, I have to choose, as in all of these different examples, where is my source? My source is the link to tasks. I'm going to choose the field. In this case, I care about that days overdue. And then here is where I put in my aggregation formula. I have to have this formula, and what I put here is going to dictate what we're doing to these numbers or information in general. It doesn't have to be a number field, but in our count, we're looking at numbers and we want to sum them, the total days that tasks are overdue. And we know it's going to be 312, which is what we had on the tasks table. And just like that, it's automatically rolled up and summed for us. But we can do all kinds of different math here. We could do an average, right? Grab an average of values. And here we would see the average number of days stuff is overdue. NaN means not a number, so it can't take an average of an empty set. So that's why it's giving us this value here. But we can choose, you know, a number of different things here in our aggregation function. We can look at unique arrays. We can do averages, sums, minimums, maximums, all kinds of things. And you'll also notice that we have the same options that we did for the other field. the lookup field, where we were looking at linked records under certain conditions, and we could also sort those records before summarizing them. So if, depending on what you're doing, you know, for us, we're doing a sum or an average, it doesn't matter what order the numbers are in for that, but some things might. Like if you wanted to look at a range of unique arrayed text, you might want to put it in a specific order before returning that array. So there are numbers of different things that you can do here. All of this is to say that you've got three key different fields that help you analyze the connected records that are linked. And the last thing I want to highlight for us here is that only are we getting information if we have associated records, in this case tasks, linked to this. This is basically the same as a VLOOKUP function in Excel, if you're familiar with spreadsheets. What we're doing is saying we only care about stuff that is associated with this project, or this stuff is associated with this project, because it's linked at the record level. So, mastering these more advanced fields is what's really going to help you take your Airtable skills to the next level. Again, if you want more training on this, grab the free crash course that I mentioned at the top of the video. And of course, if you enjoyed this, we would love it if you could give us a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel. If you have questions that we did not address here, you can also swing by our website because we've put a ton of resources together for you there. But the most important thing, my friend, keep on building.